the disintegrated, like, abandoned works that happened later on. But yeah, that's the first plank of the bookshelf tour. Hope you guys enjoyed it, and we'll see you on the next one. Take care. Okay, so we kind of stopped on Beckett. Got pushed down because I got more books here, but we can kind of look at this little section here. I had this dream the other night where I was on this panel discussion and we were talking about the role of Westerns in literature, and, you know, kind of going a little bit beyond that would be like the idea of a spectral Western where, you know, you're a stranger in a new land, but the land ends up being more strange than you are. And we got books here that, you know, if you haven't read, these guys are pretty amazing. It's like literature based on literature. We got this one. Now, if you look at the surface area of the rectangles, it seems like it's correlated to the popularity of the author at the time. And I found, holy shit! If you think of literature, sort of like this human body that, you know, has organs. These guys would be like the organs within the human body that would be studied probably for years to come, even by people who are not yet born, at least from like a 20th century perspective. Kind of think of criticism as being like this blanket that falls over the author and its work. So like if you were to talk about someone like Evandara, you know, you'd be saying the same things that other people would be saying, but I kind of want to see or get to the point where, you know, any interpretation is allowed, even massive misreadings, you know, is actually preferred. And so then you start to see like different shapes, you know, towers and minarets and bridges and buttresses that start to form in the shroud. And that's where, you know, it's a different type of creativity, I think. Anyways, this book came out not too long ago. It kind of shows his early works, I think, and also more clearly his method, which, you know, he used in books like Locus Solus, where he got these crazy inventors creating these like dreamlike projects that are described in a real matter-of-fact way, and as if appealing also to the attentions of some sort of external force or patron, as if their attention would redeem them somehow. Kind of think about Borges' library and Wilson Harris, you know, with his quantum theories applied to fiction. I like this idea of a potential literature that just can be created to the point where any book can exist written by any author.
Book haul.
One said, issue number 8, Joe Wenderoth. More excerpts from Agony, which this book, it seems like it's been decades in the making. It's supposed to be the follow-up to Letters to Wendy, which came out in 2000. And check this out. Published posthumously is this one by Don DeLillo. It's kind of like a return to form, if you like his early stuff. I was talking about Ben Marcus earlier, and some of us like his earlier work so much to where someone had snuck into the archives of Brown University and pulled his master's thesis, and it got published as this book here, where he goes even more crazy than Age of Wire and String. We have Welbeck being controversial as always, and the crown jewel of the book haul. This was after Volman finished his Seven Dreams, and he just couldn't leave it alone, so he started making these interstitial dreams, and I think this one is about Captain Cook in Hawaii. I think that's a typo, though. Then there's some books that exist already that can sit on that dream shelf, like this one here by Gerald Murnane. I began to wonder, what's the point? Is it maybe to show that this entire collection is a single work, where each book is like a paragraph within that work, a single organism or dream that you never want to wake up from? But then you do wake up and you're back in the real world, just wandering the same rooms, the same views, tiptoeing past the dead bedroom. Out here, you're free in the same way that you're reading. You actually are continuing to read. You're sort of creating the world as you're walking through it. And not only that, but imagining that another reader has found you and you are reading her at the same time. You're both creating this alternate reality in a double dream together. This book here is the most well-known book by Gerald Murnane, and it actually started out as being sliced off pieces of a much larger work, which for some reason couldn't get published, so it just got condensed and put into this little jewel of a book, which I think, you know, you could read this every year for the rest of your life and still get something out of it because it's just so impeccably written, but also serves to be as an appetizer into the larger body of his work, which these are some examples of right here. But not only that, these books are just only the tip of what is an even larger dreamscape that exists, unpublished in the filing cabinets in his room in Australia. Now, you could take the idea of Ulupo as performing different operations on semantic objects, but extending it beyond like words and paragraphs and books all the way into different countries, so that if you were an alien just landed down, you see transplanted cultures in places, creating entirely new worlds. Maybe it's not the words themselves that are read, but the shapes of the white space surrounding the words that contain the actual meaning. To see the world, but also as a way to worship this girl who had gotten raped and threw herself down a well in Hungary over 100 years ago. Books as being just tools to help you unbury this female personage whose river you had once commingled with every day. What if this is all actually an escape to where any wrong step could lead to massive harm, when all along it's your insistence to explore that's causing her to plant these landmines in front of you, almost without knowing why? So the only way to survive is to keep moving from one window to the next, just studying these planes that you'll never fully be able to grasp the expanse of, taking notes for this project that she'll never actually see. I think that's the reason why I read, is to create this world and to walk alongside someone who no longer exists, who I can somehow make come alive again.